said that we're the Highest Street Missionary Baptist Church. We're so thankful for your presence, all of you, the bounty, all of you in attendance today, and all of our friends online. We are here to worship the Lord, and this is our call to worship. Please say amen. Let's give glory to God this morning.
Went unto the chief priests.
And said unto them,
portray you.
Now the first day of the feast of the unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying unto him, "Where would I have been prepared for thee to eat Passover?"
And he said, "Go into the city to such a man, and say unto him, The master said, My time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at thy house with my disciples."
And the disciples did as Jesus had appointed him, and they made ready the Passover.
Now, when the even was come, he sat down with the 12.
And as they did eat, he said, "Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me."
And they were exceeding sorrowfully, and began every one of them to say unto him, "Lord, is it I?"
And he answered and said, "He that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me.
The Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. But woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born."
Then Judas, which betrayed him, asked him, saying, "Master, is he alive?" He said unto him, "Thou hast said."
And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body."
And he took the cup, and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it.
This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins.
But I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom."
And when they had sung and hymned, they went out into the Mount of Olives.
Then said Jesus unto them, "All ye shall be offended from us beneath this life. For it is written, I will smite the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock shall be scattered abroad."
All together.
"But after I am risen again, I will go before you into Galilee."
Thank you. sin against you and our brother, Father. Because sometimes we get hung up on our circumstances that lead to what the Lord says. Thank you, Father, for giving us everything we need. And sometimes our new things that you want. And we thank you. And I pray this for your son Jesus.
Thank you. God our Father, how grateful we are for this matchless and marvelous privilege of preaching your word. As we approach this preaching moment, oh God, we pray that you will hide me in the shadow of yonder cross. It is that people can see and hear none of you, but all of you. Holy Spirit, continue to have your way in this place. Continue to move us, through us, and around us, and about us. Oh, just have your way. Oh, Holy Ghost, we give you all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. It will belong to you alone. Grant now for believing minds and receptive hearts to what the Spirit has to say. Here we are, yielded in spirit. In Him who is our Christ and soon coming King, we pray. And all the saints of God say together,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, choir. Amen. Awesome job this morning.
Amen.
You can tell when somebody's been praying.
Yes.
Amen. It's a great move of the Spirit in this place.
Yes.
Feels good in here today.
Yes.
To all of you who are in the audience and those who are joining us by social media, we greet you in the name of Him who is our Christ, one who does all things well.
Yes.
There is a word this morning that has already been read responsibly, and I shall read verses 21 and 22 as our foundational verses, and of course move with other scriptures that are supporting. And for those who are here, I just stopped by this morning on my way to heaven.
Amen.
As one beggar to tell other beggars where they can find bread. Place where the sick can be made well. And where the well can be made better. And where the dying can find eternal life. But most of all, I came to tell you that the tomb is empty. Because the tomb is empty. Oh, we have life and have it more abundant.
Yes.
And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and began every one of them to say unto him, Lord, grass is still withering, flowers are still fading, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Lord, is it I? Can we all say together,
Lord,
is it I? Thank you, ushers. At this season of the year, we began our road to Calvary. And this road to Calvary is a winding road. It's a road that Jesus came to straighten out for us. John the Baptist paved the way. And he said, I came to make straight the holy feet of our God, to create a pathway to make way for our God. He came to pay a debt that the crooked places can be made straight and the rough places can be made smooth and the high places can be brought low and valleys can be exalted. But then on his way, as he's making his way to the hour from which he was born, he says, for this hour came I into the world. So now his hour has come. And so he gathered his disciples together. And in that first verse it says, then one of them, one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priest, who was Caiaphas, went unto the chief priest. This section, verses 14 and 15, deals with the treachery of Judas. One of the 12. I don't know what your number is, but this is one of the 12. It could be one of one. One of you will betray me. One who lived with me. One who followed the Lord Jesus, who listened to his words. One who was his traveling companion. One of the 12. One of the 12 who has seen his miracles. He has seen him walk the water, who had come to see that, had seen him heal the sick and cast out demons and made people whole and heard his incomparable teaching. One of them could witness his miracle. Psalm 41 and 9 said, it was my familiar friend, one who ate my bread, one who had lifted up his heel against me, the Son of God. He's the one that went to the chief priest for 30 pieces of silver. In our day, it's $15. In contrast to the woman who was at Simon's house, who gave her all, who broke her alabaster box because she valued him. The question is, how much do you value him? She valued him highly, but Judas valued him lowly. How do you value him? That's the question. That's the question for us today. What a dreadful and contemptible bargain this was. He was one of them. The psychologist coined the phrase, Jennifer Fraud, the trauma of betrayal. What is the trauma of betrayal? It's a breach of trust. And usually it's by someone that is intimate, someone that is close to you. The enemy is okay, but with somebody that's close to you, in your own house, betray your trust, violate the boundaries of our relationship, my familiar friend, it's painful for leader to have those who are in his group, as in his number, to betray them. Have to deal with many instances with preachers and pastors across the country in our capacity when the those in the number rise up against us. No hood like a pastor and a preacher who's been betrayed by one of his own. There's no hood like church hood. No hurt like church when you violate the boundaries. It happens when there's intimacy in the relationship. Oh, Joe Blow, you know, no problem. Well, we can deal with that. But then in the relationship, a marital relationship, when there's a violation of the boundaries, when you say in sickness and in health, and then I get sick, and then she goes looking for the man in the new gym. All right. The big boss fellow. And then sickness and in hell, and I get sick. And then she wants the big muscle man. And we say for better or for worse, but when I get worse, then here you say, I can do bad by myself. When you violate the boundary, the impact of betrayal is like a punch in the gut. Yes. It lingers. Yes. Not a stranger, it's one that I, not in a million years, would I have suspected this person to betray my trust. And the impact is, it's hard to trust that person again.
All right now.
Hard to trust.
problem becomes it's hard to trust anybody. Because some people never get over it. And you charge the new relationship with what happened in the old relationship. But you got to fix yourself. In order to go forward. You remember David? His favorite son, Absalom. Handsome Absalom. Who betrayed him. Who started a revolt against his own father. And he was the favorite of the son. And he started a revolt against his father. He broke his father's heart.
Yes, yes,
Lord. Shakespeare says, how sharper than the serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. A thankless child.
Yeah.
It's hard to do. I mean, verse 17. Now the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the disciples came to Jesus and saying unto him, where wilt thou prepare for thee to eat the Passover? Now we have Jesus now is about to connect the dots between the Old and New Testament. Jesus is now planning every detail as he does with your life. There are no coincidence in this divine providence. This is when divine sovereignty interacts with human responsibility. He's about to connect the dots now because he planned it. There's preparation, then there are resources, but then you got to execute. And so the disciples asked the question, where will we prepare the Passover? What does the Passover consist of? It consists of bitter herbs, roasted lamb, and unleavened bread. Bitter herbs, roasted lamb, and unleavened blood. But don't forget the blood. The blood over the doorposts. That's Jesus Christ. Because nothing but the blood is the blood. That's the lifeblood of a person. It's the blood of Jesus. And so we're going to prepare that he prepares a table before us. Because it's go see a man, an unnamed man, because there were conspirators who were plotting to take Jesus' life. And as a result, we had to do it suddenly. By subtle means, it's this unnamed man that's going to tell you where we're going to have the Passover supper.
Yes, sir.
And so then they prepare preparation, resource, and execute. He will do that for you in your life. When enemies come upon you, all you got to do is just stand on his word. All you got to do is just be right. Or you may lose at the outset, but you win in the end. I tell you over and over and over that they can let them lie on you. But it will be for a while because truth will always overcome the lie. You don't have to, it will always vindicate you. All you got to do is just stand on him. When you've done all to stand, then you just stand and bleed. And I promise you, he'll come see about it. I'm a different witness that for you. Let him conspire against you. Let him conspire because they will come against you, but no weapon formed against you will prosper. None will prosper. But look here what he's done. Now Jesus is in verse 17 through 19, and he said, go into the city, and then you're going to see a man. And all you have to do is just tell him that the master has need. Because everything belongs to him. And so he wants what is. Some of us are sitting on things that belong to the master, and he wants it to edify the body of Christ. But you're sitting on stuff and resources and talent that he has resident in you that he needs for the betterment of this body. To edify the body of Christ. He's given every man something. He said, go to the city and you're going to see that man because my time has come. And the disciple did as Jesus appointed. But look at this. Now, here is the Passover is when represents when they were leaving Egypt. Because the last plague really got the job done. And then Moses had these instructions. The Passover came before the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. The Feast of the Unleavened Bread, this is where he connect the dots. Now the Feast of the Unleavened Bread was 7 days. So this was a total of 8 days. And 8 numerologically in the Bible represents a new beginning. So this is a new beginning. And so, my sisters and brothers, as they sat and meet at the time of the announcement, then he says to them, as they sat at meat, recline in the culture of the time. And as they sat at meat, and when you're sitting at meat in the culture of the time, it has sociological implication. Not just you come over and have some barbecue, and then we'll have some fried fish. No, it has deep sociological implication. Let me, I accept you. We are intimate. And as a result of this intimacy, then Jesus made the grand announcement. One of you, so make your friends. I don't know if you've been betrayed before, but then I'm telling you, it's a painful thing. But betray the Son of Man. One of you. This is personal. It's penetrating. It's purposeful. It's provoking. And it's painful. One of you. So they began to be sorrowful. Nobody looked at Judas. Oh, it must be Judas. No, nobody looked at Judas. It became a point of self-examination when we examine ourselves. Have I betrayed you?
Yes, sir.
This is basically what they were doing. One of them was not specific. It was one of the 12. One that I handpicked when I pictured my guy he knew it. One who was sitting at the table. One of your friends.
Yes, sir.
And they began to ask a master. Each one, including Judas. Nobody said, well, Judas. Because they were examining themselves. Lord, that's the question that we can table today. Have we betrayed him in words or deeds? Have we betrayed him when we didn't show up, when we didn't do what we could do for the master every day? That's a question for us. By my actions or by my inactions? How have I betrayed him? That's for everyone. We can't point a finger at anybody. One, then this deception, this disloyalty, this breach of trust, this breach of a fiduciary relationship, and then to do it with a kiss, a sign of intimacy. That's a question for all of us. We can't point to anybody else. They asked him, is it? The purpose of self-examination is it's like a schoolmaster evaluating for us, for we ask ourselves. Now, it's the purpose of evaluation. How have we grown as a result of it? Just like a sergeant, though many of us have been in the military, and you've seen the drill sergeant in the recruit's face asking them these questions. In the face, sometimes those who've been in the military, sometimes they'll do it low down. They'll eat some garlic and they'll get right in your face. Not in passing in review many times because the generals and the captains and will watch us pass in review, but then the drill sergeant right in your face. That's how we examine ourselves. Like a lawyer cross-examining a hospital witness. That's how we do in self-examination, because we want to be real. That's why I ask myself, because I don't want my worship to be for real. I want it to be for real. And so we have to examine ourselves. It keeps us focused, and it helps us for self-improvement, because all of us can stand some self-improvement. It allows us to listen to the inner voice, to listen to the Holy Spirit speak to us. And you don't have to do it with, you know, with a sense of hostility. It's not a harsh judgment. It's just an invitation to grow, to learn, and to improve. So here Jesus is connecting the dots between the Old Testament and the New Testament. He is inaugurating a new covenant. Because the Passover is, I am the way. You see the blood, you're leaving Egypt, which means you're leaving sin. And you can't have unleavened bread because leaven in bread caused the bread to rise. It's an indication of sin. And so I'm leaving Egypt now, which means I'm leaving sin. I'm leaving my past behind. I know you want to ask me about my resume, but he doesn't check my past. He doesn't check my past. The church is the only place where we can't tell people about our problems. We can't tell our issues because people have a high estimation as to who we are, and we think we're all of this. Confident, holy, deep, and wonderful, but on the inside. But I want to have church at church and church at home. I don't want to have church at church and have hell at home. And so they left Egypt with that unleavened bread, bread that had time to rise. And every Jewish house at this time has to rid itself during this period of any yeast that's in the house during this period, which is a symbolic of sin. It's a 7-day feast plus the Passover, which is 7 days, new beginning. The meal, the bitter herbs, that represents the bitterness that we endured while we were in 400 years of slavery. The unleavened bread without sin and the roasted lamb. That's why we eat the bread. Because when we eat the bread and drink the wine, we become a part of his body. And as a result, this institutes a new relationship and new covenant. That's why Colossians 2, 16 and 17 said, let no man judge you by meat or drink or respect of holy days or in a new moon or on the Sabbath day. Don't let them judge you by that. Because this is a new arrangement. Verse 17 says, which are a shadow of things to come out of the body of Christ. So when we got our Old Testament, it was pointing to Christ. And so now he connects the dots between the old and the new. So we don't have to go back to the old ritual because it's in me. That's why in Hebrew he says, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, from the Genesis to the Revelation, is written of me. Adam, it was the man. Abraham, it was the nation. Jacob, it was the Jesus tribe. Isaiah, his family. Micah, the town. Daniel, his time. Mary, his person. An angel pointed to his date, and the star pointed to his birthplace. So the whole book is about me. So I came in the volume of the book not to do my will, but to do his will, said the Lord. I close today. But this is an invitation. When we ask the question, Lord, is it? I have to ask myself, not pointing my fingers to anybody, I have to ask myself, Lord, how have I misrepresented you? I don't want to stand before your people and then as if I'm serving them out of a dirty cup. I don't want to stand before my people, oh God, and then I'm waving the belt and then found wanting. Because I don't want my running to be in vain. In this invitation for self-examination today, because all of us are capable of leaving people wounded and half dead on the Jericho Road. I don't care how holy we walk, how many scriptures we talk, how many tongues we can speak in. All of us have seen and come short of the glory of God. And all of us are capable of some of the most despicable. because we can't point a finger at anybody. And there's sometimes we are so messed up from the flow up until, you know, we can't even trust our own hearts. Because of the experience that we have gone through. We've gone through some bitterness, some anger, and some betrayal, some mistreatment, some hard feelings sometimes. And sometimes we can't trust our own heart because some of our past experience have shaped us how we see the world. The lens that we have, we denied him. That's the issue before us today. Lord is God. Lord is God. It's the value of self-awareness. It's an invitation for self-examination. But finally, it's the immutability of God. That agape love, he changes not. He changes not. Even when we went through circumstances beyond our control, he never changed. When we betray him sometime, he never changed. When we deny him, he won't change. He still loves us in spite of ourselves. When we forsake him in words and in deed, even in the Garden of Gethsemane, when they went to sleep, their prayer partners go to sleep on you. Three times he went and came. Each time he came back, the prayer partners were asleep. Peter, James, and John. Sometimes people will go to sleep on you. But Jesus said, sleep on me. Take your rest. And that's what we have to do, my sisters and brothers. And he told Peter, deny him. I will never deny you. I'll go to jail with you. I'm willing to die for you. Peter, look, Peter, I know you mean well. But before then, three times you would have denied me. But I'm so glad Peter went off with the godless sorrow. He went off and cried, trying to deal with his own issue. But he had him to know that, Peter, I know you dropped the ball. Pastor Marsh, you dropped the ball sometimes, but when you get over your failure, when you get through crying, when you convert, strengthen your brother. When you turn around, make a new start. Strengthen your brother. And that's why I tell you, my sisters and brothers, it's because of that old cross that Jesus died for me. He went to the grave, but he got out Sunday morning. And as a result, that's why I tell him, Lord, keep me. Can I get a witness? Lord, keep me day by day. Oh, I want to, because I want to live in the building, not made by him. Lord, keep me. Keep my body strong. Keep my temple strong. Because I don't want to do no wrong. God, keep me day by day. Because I want to live in a building, not made by him. That's why I don't want to deny you. That's why every morning I say, I will bless the Lord at all times. And his praises shall Do you want your crown?
Yes.
Have we betrayed him today? Have I called someone to go astray? I tried to help somebody along the way. Because he says, as you do unto the least of these, you do it unto me. Be careful with the least of these. Because he says, that's where I show up. And those who cannot fend for themselves, the very least of these, don't deny him with your life. With the decisions that you make, they might be. And sometimes we get weak sometimes along the way. You're going to get weak. But if when you give the best of yourself, that's what he wants. The best of yourself. He won't want to hear himself. Give him the best. He knows when you've done the best because he's already given the best. It's only begotten Son. But there was a little more today. Shall we stand to our feet, those on the line, become a part of this great fellowship? Become a part of this church, all of the
No matter how you turn around. Some ask whether or not I give on the cross or should I give on the net. The answer is, you can't be the devil. No matter how you turn around. And we've been here for a while, we bring back to this operation table. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.
bread symbolizes the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that was bruised, broken for us on Calvary. And we eat in gratitude for what he has done for us. And as often as we eat it, we're showing forth his death and suffering until he comes again. May we eat together. Wine symbolizes the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that was shed for us on Calvary. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And as often as we drink it, we show it forth his death and suffering until he comes again. May we drink it.
Please see Sister Star. And this time, before we do the sick get our online giving, PayPal, Cash App, and Operation Payoff. We're continuing with all Operation Payoff. We're still seeking donations.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Our Wednesday is fast approaching. It is March 24th at 2:30 and March 24th at 2:30. Our guest speaker is going to be Congressman Benny Thompson, the governor of the state. He's a dynamic speaker. I think sometimes we take the congressman for granted because he's been ours for so long.
Amen.
But last year, if you notice, I've been counting myself on January 6th. Hearings. It thrust him to a national spotlight. He presided as well as any judge or leader I've ever seen. Benny Thompson, he's going to pack the house. And I want him to feel what Pine Street feels like. So I don't want him to be much of it, but I want him to be Pine Street.
All right.
Now, as far as our choir, I don't have to tell you about our band choir. You've got to take it.